Special Committee.
Mr. Speaker, I rise to move that, notwithstanding the presentation of the report of the committee established to investigate the bribery allegation made against the chairman and some members of the appointments committee on Wednesday, 29th March 2017, and having regard to the expiration of the 30-day period commencing 31st January 2017, granted the committee to submit its report, this, your committee, pursuant to standing orders 5 and 6, seeks leave of Mr. Speaker and the indulgence of the House to proceed on this matter. I so move.
It's for consideration of the House. All those in favor of the motion say aye. Those against say no. The ayes have it. The motion is carried. Item number 4. Chairman of the Special Committee. Motion.
I move that this Honorable House adopts the report of the committee to investigate the bribery allegation made against the chairperson and so members of the appointments committee. And so moving, Mr. Speaker, I pray that the Hansard captures the report as having been read in its entirety. But Mr. Speaker, I crave your indulgence to speak on a few essential parts of the report. Mr. Speaker, the report is about 50 pages, but I will not speak, I will not read the whole report. Mr. Speaker, on 31st January 2017, the first Deputy Speaker of Parliament, the first Deputy Speaker and Member of Parliament for Bekwai, a chairman of the Appointments Committee, made a statement on the floor of the House. Mr. Speaker, the member drew the attention of the House to an allegation of bribery which had been made against him and some of the members of the Appointments Committee. Mr. Speaker, a second statement on the same matter was made on the same day. And this was made by the Honorable Member for Efidiasi Asokore, Dr. Nana Ayuafri. Mr. Speaker, as a result of these two statements, and after deliberations by the House, Mr. Speaker ruled that it was not just a matter of privilege, but it was a matter that fell within a matter of public interest, and therefore Mr. Speaker could appoint a special or ad hoc committee to deal with this matter. Mr. Speaker, after your ruling, a motion was moved and a special committee was established. Mr. Speaker, the special committee was chaired by my good self, Joe Ghartey, and had Honorable Ben Abdallah Banda, member for Fiso South, Ms. Ama Koma Boatin, a member for Joabin, Mr. Magnus Kofi Amwate, member for Yellow Crobo, Mr. Benson Tongo Baba, member for Tennessee. Mr. Speaker, Ms. Abna Drua Mensa, the member for Aten North, also deserves special mention as she attended all the meetings of the committee. As well, other members of parliament had time to attend the meeting. Mr. Speaker, your committee decided that it will be limited by Order 197 of the standing orders. Your committee also decided that the methodology that you use was to admit oral evidence and also admit memorandum evidence. Mr. Speaker, this is not a strange methodology. Our committees in Parliament admit evidence either orally or by memorandum. At our first meeting, we decided to call four witnesses, namely Honorable Joseph Osewusu, Honorable Mohammed Mutaka, Honorable Mahama Ayariga, and then Honorable Wachaja. At the same time, Mr. Speaker, we wrote to all members of the Appointments Committee that if they were interested in providing information to us, they should submit memoranda. Mr. Speaker, in addition to this letter, at one of our public sittings, and I believe it was 15th February 2017, as chairman of committee, I reiterated this and also said that the members of the Appointments Committee, being members of Parliament, knew how they could come to the committee if they so desired. Mr. Speaker, your committee received only one memorandum from Honorable Sabo Okudjetu Ablapa, and we are grateful to him for attending onto the committee. Mr. Speaker, the evidence of the first deputy speaker indicates, in summary, that he never had any money dealings with the energy minister, Mr. Bwacha Ajaku, that he had never received any money, that he had never distributed any money. The interesting thing about this evidence was that he alleged, or he stated, that at a certain point in time when they went into conclave, Honorable Samuel Okudjeta Blackwa made a statement that the reason or the motive why it had come out or rumors were about that the deputy speaker had been a conduit for some bribery was because, in the words of the deputy speaker, equalization. Mr. Speaker, on that basis, your committee decided that following the known conventions of this House, where when one member mentioned the name of another member whilst making submissions on the floor of Parliament, we called Honorable Okudjeta Blackwa to come and explain to us whether that is what he said or not. Mr. Speaker, even though we came to the conclusion that that matter was not germane, we made a finding of fact that as far as the question of equalization was concerned, Honorable Ayariga had admitted that he said it and he said it in jest. So we believed Honorable Ablakwa's story more than the Honorable First Deputy Speaker's story. Mr. Speaker, the second witness was Honorable Mahama Ayariga. We gave to him the evidence or the transcripts of conversations he had had with Radio Gold and also Joy FM. Indeed, we didn't give it to him. We gave it to him when he said that he remembered what he said. Mr. Speaker, Honorable Mahama Ayariga was asked, for example, whether Mr. Bwacha Ajaku brought money through Mr. Joseph Osewusu to give to Mohammed Mubarak to be distributed to minority members of the Appointments Committee. Mr. Speaker, we could not, in our view, provide the responses that we thought you would provide. Mr. Speaker, when we come to evaluating the evidence, we shall revisit the issue. Honorable Mohammed Mubarak Mutaka was attended. Honorable Mutaka expressed surprise at what was being said. He expressed surprise about his alleged role in this matter. He said he had never received money, never given money, never talked about money in the manner in which it was alleged that he had been the conduit for some form of bribery. Mr. Speaker, our fourth witness was Mr. Bwachi Ajaku. Mr. Bwachi Ajaku also stated that he had never given any money for the purposes of distribution. Mr. Speaker, he said, as far as he was concerned, he was not aware of any problem that he had faced in his vetting. It was when he was at the Jubilee House ready to be sworn in that it came to his attention that there were a few problems with regards to the appointments committee reaching a consensus on this matter. The minority addressed three issues. One, to deal with a phrase he used that the World Bank was beating on the neck of the then president. Another, to deal with the number of floating storage regasification units, and another to deal with state-owned enterprises, the debt status of state-owned enterprises in the energy sector. According to Mr. Bwacha Ajaku, when they went into the conclave, and this conclave was a meeting that was held by the leadership and some members of the appointments committee, Mr. Speaker, in your lobby, when they went into that conclave, he managed to answer the questions to the satisfaction of the minority, and he also, as it were, withdrew his statement that the World Bank was beating on the neck of the president. And as a result, the minority joined the majority and it was passed by consensus. Mr. Speaker, I've already said that Mr. Samoku Deto Ablakwa gave oral evidence as well as submitted a memorandum. His oral evidence in his letter to us indicated that he wanted to answer the matter of equalization. We gave him the opportunity to answer it. And as I've said previously, we preferred his recollection of the fact. And we came to the conclusion that he was not the person who had said equalization in the conclave. He also submitted a written memorandum. Mr. Speaker, we examined this written memorandum, which led us to taking evidence in camera with respect to three witnesses. Honorable Samuel Okujeto Ablakwa suggested that the committee should study the CCTV footage between the hours of 11 and 1 on the day that he alleged that this incident took place. He said, if we examine the footage, we'll see a whole host of people going towards Honorable Mutaka's office holding envelopes. And in his view, this was part of the evidence which will show that he was returning the money. Because, Mr. Speaker, his recountation of the facts were that when.
Order, Honorable Member.
In the beginning, they all thought, when I said giving $3,000 each, they assumed that that was the committee allowance. Mr. Speaker, only later to hear this rumor that the money had come for Honorable Bwacha Ajaku. According to Honorable Samuel Ablakwa, upon hearing that, they decided to return the money to Honorable Mutaka, who happens to be on the 8th floor, I believe on the East Wing. So if we study the CCTV between 11 and 1, we'll see a certain stream of people going
in a convoy.
Going into Honorable Mutaka's office.
Honorable members, silence. Order.
Going into Honorable Mutaka's office with envelopes. And that perhaps would have assisted us in our deliberations. Mr. Speaker, since it was CCTV, what we did was that we called three witnesses. Mr. Speaker, we called the acting marshal, Major Retired Asigri Bachanawe Chaga. We called Mrs. Shelley Ann Fiagome, Director of ICT. I will call Mr. Ernest Berry, ICT officer. Mr. Speaker, we also paid an on-site visit to your CCT control room. But in the process, the committee was given a detailed briefing on the workings of the surveillance cameras in Parliament. Mr. Speaker, Parliament recognizes that it is not all matters that should be discussed in public domain. Order 44 of the Standing Orders of Parliament prescribes the procedure to be followed where there is a matter which is in the interest of the public or in the interest of Parliament that it shouldn't be discussed. And Mr. Speaker, I would want to quote this part with your kind indulgence. It says, Mr. Speaker, may in consultation with the House and having regard to the public interest, order the House to move into closed sitting to discuss a particular subject or for the remainder subject matter or for the remainder of the sitting. When the House is in closed sitting, no stranger shall be permitted to be present in the chamber, side lobbies, or galleries. Mr. Speaker may cause the proceedings and decisions of a closed sitting to be recorded or issued in such a manner as he thinks fit. No member, no person, other than a member or person acting through the authority of Mr. Speaker, shall keep a record or note of any proceedings or decision of a closed sitting, whether in part or in full. No person, other than a person acting under the authority of Mr. Speaker, shall issue any report of or purport to describe the proceedings of any decision of a closed sitting. Mr. Speaker, having listened to the evidence of the three witnesses, the committee is of the view that it is in the nature of the evidence envisaged under Order 44. The evidence, if made public, shall compromise the security of Parliament because it describes the workings of our surveillance, our CCTV surveillance. Mr. Speaker, that evidence is in my possession, and taking a cue from Order 44, I shall submit it to you for your keeping. Suffice it to say that the committee found nothing as far as that evidence is concerned relating to the kind of envelopes that was useful for our purposes. Mr. Speaker, another matter that engaged the mind of your committee was what standard of proof to use in evaluating the evidence. Mr. Speaker, we recognize that your committee is a fact-finding committee. And even though the standing orders gives committees of parliament the powers of a high court in certain circumstances, this does not make those committees a court. But in evaluating the evidence, your committee was of the view that it has to state what standard of proof it was adopting to evaluate the evidence. Mr. Speaker, our law does not recognize one standard. It recognizes what the standard for civil actions, the balance of probability, and the standard also for criminal actions, which is proof beyond doubt, reasonable doubt. Your committee was of the view that it is improper to arrive at a conclusion without indicating the basis for it. In other words, the standard of proof that your committee used to rely or to evaluate the evidence. Mr. Speaker, I must confess that your committee was not at a meeting of minds as to what standard to use. Those who argued that the criminal standard should be used said that even though it was not a criminal trial, because of the nature of the accusation, it would be wrong to use any other standard. Because I remember vividly that the example was made that if an honorable member is accused or by another honorable member of lying or not, or for example, not being fair to the person, and you set up a committee to investigate the matter, that committee will use the standard of the balance of probabilities. But if an honorable member is accused by another one of stealing or murder. When your committee is examining the matter, they cannot use the civil standard, but they will use the standard of beyond reasonable doubt, reserved for criminal trials. Those who made the argument, Mr. Speaker, found solace and refuge in Section 31 of the Evidence Act 1975, NRCD 323, which provides, and with your permission, Mr. Speaker, I will read. In a civil or criminal action, the burden of persuasion as the commission by a party of a crime, which is directly issued, requires proof beyond reasonable doubt. Mr. Speaker, so even in civil actions involving land, for example, if the question of fraud arises, with regards to the proof of fraud, the standard that will be used will be the criminal standard and not the civil standard. Mr. Speaker, they argue that that does not make the trial a criminal trial. There's still a plaintiff and a defendant, and the person who has been found, who has been accused of fraud in the course of civil proceedings, does not become an accused person in a criminal trial. Mr. Speaker, so for the two people who were of the view that we should use this test, the question is, what is the nature of the matter you are investigating? That is the test. Not even what is the procedure you are using. And for them, because the matter we are investigating is bribery and attempted bribery, which is a criminal offense, the standard that must be used is the criminal standard. Mr. Speaker, they didn't have their way. Unanimity was not achieved. The other group, another two, said that since it is not a criminal trial, so sensible, the test that must be used is the balance of probabilities. Mr. Speaker, the committee was unanimous in the view that they will evaluate the evidence both based on both these standards. They will look at the evidence and evaluate it on the basis of proof beyond reasonable doubt. They will look at the evidence and evaluate it on the basis of standard balance of probabilities. And they added a third one. They will say they will use the test of a reasonable man. Reasonable man being a man sitting in a trot to Medina. If it's presented with these facts, what would the man say? The Speaker, people are asking me that, where is the man going from Medina to where? Mr. Speaker, he's going from Accra to Medina. By the time he reaches Medina, Mr. Speaker, he would have made up his mind. Mr. Speaker, we then proceeded to evaluate the evidence. The first term of reference that was given to us is to establish whether the first Deputy Speaker, Mr. Joseph Osewusu, took money from the Energy Minister Designate, Mr. Bwachi Ajako, and gave it to the Minority Chief Whip, Alhaji Mohammed Mubarak Mutaka, to be distributed to members of the Appointments Committee. And Mr. Speaker, I crave your indulgence that with regards to the evaluation of evidence, I shall read almost everything. In his evidence before the committee, Honorable Joseph Osewusu maintained that he had never received any money from Mr. Bwachi Ajako. He said inter alia as follows: I have never discussed, requested, demanded, or received money of whatever country for myself or my committee, for Mr. Bwachi Ajako or any other person for that matter. Neither have I discussed, offered, or given money to Honorable Mohammed Mutaka Mubarak for himself or for the members of the Minority on the Appointments Committee. The allegation of Honorable Mohammed Ayariga is therefore a colossal untruth which has done grievous damage to my reputation, my heart, and integrity. Mr. Speaker, he had also made a similar denial on Joy FM when he phoned into the Newsfile program on 28th January 2017. Mr. Speaker, your committee came to the conclusion that there can be nothing more emphatic than this, and that Honorable Joy also have at all times denied, been consistent in his denial of any involvement in any matters alleged. But Mr. Speaker, your committee did not rest there, because your committee was of the view that a mere denial of an allegation, no matter how vigorous it is put, does not by itself exonerate a person for what the person is alleged to have done. we decided to go a step further and determine whether or not there was any evidence that may support what Honorable George was asserting, or any evidence that points to the contrary. Mr. Speaker, Mr. Mahama Ayariga, in his evidence, stated that there were rumors that the money he was alleged to have collected from Honorable Mohammed Mutaka had come from Honorable Bwacha Ajaku. Honorable Mahama Ayariga insisted in his evidence that he had never dealt with Honorable George Sewusu or Honorable Bwacha Ajaku on the issue of money. In fact, this same thing was said on Joy News File, 28th January 2017, and almost a month later when he appeared before your committee on the same matter. He was asked, and I quote, Mr. Chairman, by the chairman, that Mr. Speaker, my good self, I think it is also a fact that you said you do not receive money directly from Joseph Osewusu. Honorable Ayariga, Mr. Chairman, yes. I also said as a fact that I never received money directly from Honorable Ajaku, and I also never received money from Honorable Joseph Osewusu. These are also facts. Mr. Speaker, Honorable Mohammed Mubarak Mutaka, the minority chief, also denied ever receiving money from Mr. Bwacha Ajaku or Joseph Osewusu. He also denied having a conversation with anyone, including Honorable Ayariga, concerning the matter and issue. He said, and I quote, Mr. Speaker, I say that I have never had an alleged conversation with Honorable Ayariga or anybody whatsoever, and that the said Honorable Chairman, Honorable Joseph Osewusu, has never had an alleged conversation with me, and I have never reported any said non-existent conversation with anybody. He also maintained that he had not given money to anybody or received money from anyone for the purposes of influence decision granting relative to the approval of Honorable Bwacha Ajaku. And consequently, since he had given no money, no money could have been returned to him. I mean, Mr. Speaker, you collect that. We were asked to examine a CCTV that will show money, envelopes being returned to him. He said that he had not received, he had not given any money, so no money could be returned to him. Now, Mr. Speaker, Honorable Okudjete Ablakwa, in his memorandum, said, and I quote, the morning after I picked up my envelope and I was in the Chamber of Parliament, it became evident from information gleaned from other members of the House that the envelopes we picked up, which we thought contained our allowances, were actually from another source. This was the morning of Friday, 27 February, 2017. Friday, 27 January, Mr. Speaker, excuse me, 2017. At this point, two members of our side on the Appointments Committee then decided to verify from the Chairman of the Appointments Committee, Honorable Joseph Osewusu, if there was any substance in what was making the rounds. These two members received confirmation from the chairman, Honorable Joseph Osewusu, that money we had received was not our allowance as we thought, and that the envelopes contained 3,000 cedis each from Mr. Bwacha Ajaku. At this moment, those of us on the minority side of the Appointments Committee in the chamber quickly conferred with our leaders, and we decided to hold an emergency meeting in the office of our chief whip, Honorable Mohammed Mubarak Mutaka. At the said meeting, we resolved to return the money after further checks confirmed the source. I hold the view that these two members of the appointment committee referred to in the previous paragraph, who confronted the chairman, Honorable Joseph Osewusu, are very critical in unraveling this matter. Subject to the committee's willingness to offer them hearing, I'll provide their names. May I add that these two members have also expressed their desire and determination to fully cooperate with the esteemed committee. This, unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, is our view, does not lead the committee to the conclusion that Honorable Joseph Osewusu gave money to Honorable Mutaka, who gave money to Honorable Bwacha Ajaku. These two members that Honorable Ablakwa refers to are members of the Appointments Committee. He did not name them. In any event, the person who was tendering the evidence, Honorable Ablakwa, himself had no direct evidence. He simply said two members of the Appointments Committee had told them. It is clear that Honorable Ablakwa himself was not even relying on the evidence of these two mystery members of the appointments committee. He was merely providing a lead. He said in this regard, subject to the committee's willingness to offer them a hearing, I'll provide their names. May I add that these two members have expressed their desire and determination to fully cooperate with your esteemed committee. Mr. Speaker, it is on record that the committee had previously written to all members of the appointments committee, including these two ministry members, to show how they could be assistance to the special committee. On February 15, 2017, I also stated, and I quote, any other member of the appointments committee who has any information that will be useful to the committee should submit the memorandum. Upon receipt of the memorandum, we will decide if it's necessary to call the person as a witness, or we shall examine the memorandum that the person has submitted and prepare of the appointments committee who did not appear before the committee or submit memorandum, including the two ministry members, had decided to hold their horses. All the members of the appointment committee knew how to attend the special committee if they so desired. Mr. Speaker, cannot therefore rely on the hearsay evidence mentioning two ministry members of the appointments committee. Mr. Speaker, in the circumstance, with regards to the first issue or term of reference, which is to establish whether first deputy speaker, Mr. Joseph Osewusu, took money from the energy minister, Mr. Bwacha Ajaku, and gave it to the minority chief whip, Honorable Alhaji Muhammad Mubarak Mutaka, to be distributed to the members of the appointments committee, the committee is unanimous that there is no evidence that Honorable Bwacha Ajaku gave money to the Honorable Joseph Osewusu to bribe members of the appointments committee. Furthermore, there is no evidence that this committee can rely on to lead it to the conclusion that Honorable Joseph Osewusu gave money to Honorable Muhammad Mutaka for the purposes of bribing the members of the appointments committee or for any other purpose at all. Mr. Speaker, your committee is of the view that a multiplicity of rumors does not metamorphosize a rumor into a fact. Mr. Speaker, we want to reiterate that in making the above finding of fact, we have used all the three tests referred to above. The test that is used in criminal trials, the test that is used in civil trials, and also the test of a reasonable man. Mr. Speaker, this time not sitting in a vehicle from Accra to Medina, but sitting in a vehicle from Sekendi to Iskandar. Mr. Speaker, the second term of reference that was to be determined by your committee was to establish whether there were attempts to bribe members of the appointments committee. Mr. Speaker, Section 239 of the Criminal Offences Act 1960 and 29 is on corruption of and by public officer or juror and makes it a crime. Section 241 is an explanation as to what constitutes the corruption of a public office. It provides as follows. A person commits a criminal offence of corrupting a public officer or juror or voter in respect of the duties of office or respect of the vote if that person endeavours directly or indirectly to influence the conduct of the public officer, juror or voter in respect of the duties of the office or in respect of the vote by the gift, promise or prospect of a valuable consideration to be received by that person or any other person from any person. Thus, for there to be bribery, there must be a gift, promise, or prospect of valuable consideration to a public officer to influence the conduct of the public officer. The conduct of the public officer in this case, i.e. the decision of the appointments committee, is to whether or not to approve the nomination or recommend, the nomination of Mr. Bwacha Ajaku as energy minister. The gift or bribe is alleged 3,000 supposedly given to each minority member of the appointments committee. In this evidence, Honorable Bwacha Ajaku stated, among other things, as follows. Mr. Chairman, what I would add is only to state for the record that at no point from my vetting did I feel that the confirmation of my nomination was at risk. I therefore had no motive whatsoever to engage in influencing anybody. On the matter of constitutional requirements, I believe myself to be qualified. For the second matter of my betting, respectfully, I do not think I prefer poorly. On the third matter of committee decision, I am convinced that with a ratio of 60 to 10 majority, my party had the numbers to pass me. And even if it came to the plenary, a push came to shove, they could ride roughshod over everyone else to confirm my nomination. So I had no motive whatsoever to influence or attempt to influence anybody with regard to my confirmation. Mr. Speaker, your committee accepts this evidence for Honorable Bacha Adapo. What was his motive for paying a bribe? What evidence is there to establish a motive? No reasonable person will seek to induce people to achieve an end he will achieve in any event without any inducement. According to the evidence before the committee, agreed to all the witnesses before the committee, Honorable Bacha Adapo came to the Speaker's lobby to the conclave to resolve the differences with the minority, who then agreed to support his nomination. Indeed, Honorable Mahama Ayariga, as well as all other witnesses, made the point that the only matter that influenced their mind in changing their decision regarding the nomination of Honorable Bacha Adapo was the fact that he answered the queries they addressed to their satisfaction. In any event, if the minority had refused to support the majority to approve the nominee, it would not necessarily have impeded the nominee from receiving approval. There are several examples of ministerial nominees or nominees for ministerial appointment who have not received unanimous support, even at the primary, but have received support from the majority and have gone on to become ministers. Furthermore, your committee is at a loss. When the opportunity arose to confront this matter of alleged bribery possibly, it was turned into a laughing matter at the conclave. The Speaker, indeed, when the first Deputy Speaker raised the matter at the conclave, the answer that we got from the witnesses who appeared before the committee, who all attended that conclave in your lobby, was that they laughed. They turned it into a laughing matter. They laughed about it. Mr. Speaker, from the conclave, the first Deputy Speaker came onto this floor and presented the report of the committee. In the report, whilst presenting the report, committee members found it fit or necessary to comment on the matter. The Speaker, even if they did not catch the Speaker's eye, they could have communicated the same through their minority leader, who is also a member of the appointments committee. Relating to this issue, or term of reference, is the question whether or not 3,000 Ghana cedis was paid by the minority chief to minority members on the appointments committee. The evidence as to whether or not money was paid at all by Honorable Mohamed Mubarak Mutaka is not clear. Whilst Honorable Mohamed Mutaka swears by the Holy Quran that he did not pay any money, Honorable Mahama Ayariga also swears by the Holy Quran that he received money. Mr. Speaker, there is order. No evidence.
Order.
Mr. Speaker, there is no evidence, as stated earlier, that even if money was given to the members as a bribe, this bribe came from Honorable Bacha Adapo or from Honorable Joseph Osewusu. We regret that the existence or not of Ghana Cedis 3,000 remains a mystery. And so there's the question of who gave it to who, to be given to who. And Mr. Speaker, we have made the point that the evidence, as far as we are concerned, exonerates Honorable Bacha Adapo and Honorable Joseph Osewusu. We cannot make a finding of fact based on rumor. Your committee cannot make a finding of fact based on rumor. As we said before, the multiplicity of rumors does not and cannot by itself crystallize into a fact. The fact that it is a fact that is a rumor does not transform the rumor into a fact. Mr. Speaker, the last So with regards to this term of reference, your committee is of the view, unanimously, that there is no evidence of an attempt to bribe the members of the appointments committee by any person. Once again, your committee used the test relating to criminal trials, civil trials, as well as the test of the reasonable man, and it arrived at the same conclusion. The last term of reference for your committee was to look into a remit of complaints and assertions made by First Deputy Speaker about the matter. The First Deputy Speaker, Honorable Joseph Osoyewusu, in his statement to Parliament on 31st January 2017, concluded as follows. Mr. Speaker, I have a dilemma. My fervent heart's desire is to go to civil court to reclaim my integrity. I am, however, aware of the challenges one has to battle with in litigation involving a sitting member of Parliament. But, Mr. Speaker, you have the power to permit service of court processes on a sitting member of Parliament through your office. I crave your indulgence to assist me to ventilate my grievances in court. After dealing with the first two terms of reference, Mr. Speaker, this is the only outstanding matter. The frustration expressed by the Honourable First Deputy Speaker is regards to commencing civil proceedings. And he raises his frustration because what is looking at him in the face is Article 117 and 118 of the Constitution. Mr. Speaker, these articles that honorable members are well aware of restricts the service of processes of members of parliament and states, among other things, that where there's a certificate by the speaker that a member is attending the proceedings of a house, it is conclusive evidence of attendance and a person cannot be saved. It is because of these constitutional injunctions that the First Deputy Speaker is seeking your leave, Mr. Speaker, to serve processes on a sitting member of parliament. Mr. Speaker, the powers and privileges of Parliament emanate from the historical conflict between the Crown and the representatives of the people in the formative years of Parliament in the United Kingdom. The privileges that were developed was to protect the Commons from the excesses of the Crown. Thus, at the commencement of every Parliament in the United Kingdom, it has been the custom for the Speaker, in the name and on behalf of the Commons, to lay claim by humble petition to their ancient and undoubted rights and privileges, particularly to freedom of speech in debate, freedom from arrest, freedom of access to the Majesty whenever the occasion requires, and that the most favorable construction should be placed upon their proceedings. Even though the allegations made by the Honorable Member are defamatory without proof, since the matters that were raised have been addressed by processes within Parliament, we do not recommend that Mr. Speaker gives the First Deputy Speaker leave to serve a process on a sitting member of Parliament. After this process by Parliament of setting up a special committee to investigate this matter, we have the view that to take this matter to court will be to undermine the dignity of Parliament. The courts have not hesitated on their part to say that Parliament is a master of its own procedures and arguably its own proceedings. Mr. Speaker, we therefore resist the temptation into looking into the remit and complaints and assertions made by the First Deputy Speaker about the matter any further than what has been done, above and subject to our recommendations below. Mr. Speaker, we urge this House to join us and to say like the hymnist that the distance seen, one step enough for us. Mr. Speaker, contempt of Parliament. Mr. Speaker, the sanctions of contempt for Parliament may be found in the Parliamentary Act 1965 Act 300, the provisions of the Constitution, and the standing orders. Mr. Speaker, the sanctions include apology, standing orders 102, 2, and 3, reprimand or admonition, section 35 of the Parliamentary Act, suspension from service of the House, Section 36 of the Parliamentary Act, expulsion of member, Section 35 of the Parliamentary Act. Mr. Speaker, your committee humbly observes that after critical evaluation of the evidence adduced, Honorable Mahama Ayariga was the person who gave credence to what was circulated on social media and other media platforms as a rumor. He was a member of parliament who, in a Radio Gold interview at 5 p.m. on Friday, the 7th January, repeated a rumor that the appointments committee has been bribed by the Minister of Energy, Honorable Bachada. Mr. Speaker, this we find unfortunate, as Honorable Ayariga failed to ascertain the veracity of the rumor prior to publishing it. The committee further observed that as a result of this publication, trust and confidence among members and inter-party cohesion needed for consensus building at the appointments committee, indeed all other committees, has broken down considerably. Individual members of the appointments committee have become just suspicious of each other. Mr. Speaker, the chairman of the appointments committee indicated his distrust for Mr. Mahama Ayariga, whilst Alhaji Mohammed Mubarak Mutaka stressed that it would be difficult to deal with his accusers. The reputation of parliament and the image of the institution has been greatly injured by the allegation. The reputation and dignity of the first deputy speaker, other members of the appointments committee, and that of the Minister for Energy have equally suffered considerable damage. As a result of these observations, your committee comes to the firm conclusion that Honorable Mahama Ayariga is in contempt of parliament on the strength of Article 112 of the 1992 Constitution, Section 32 of the Parliamentary Act, 1965 Act 300, and Orders 28 and 32 of the Standing Orders of Parliament. The committee came to this conclusion because Honorable Mahama Ayariga failed to prove that indeed Honorable Bachi Ajaku had given money to Honorable George Sehusu to be distributed to members of the committee with a view to bribe them, but all the same published this information. Mr. Speaker, having established a case of contempt against Honorable Mahama Ayariga, as well as having examined the sanctions regime available, the committee, your committee, recommends to the House as follows: that the Honorable Member for Boko Central, Mr. Mahama Ayariga, be reprimanded by Right Honorable Speaker in accordance with Section 35 of the Parliament Act 1965 Act 300. That Mr. Mahama Ayariga renders an unqualified apology to the House and thereby purge himself of the contempt. Mr. Speaker, in giving you these recommendations rather than the harsher ones, the committee took the note of the fact that Honorable Mahama Ayariga is not known to engage in acts that tend to disrupt the smooth proceedings of Parliament. Neither does he have the penchant or reputation or engaging in activity which can bring the image and dignity of Parliament into disrepute. The Speaker, indeed, what is known in law as a first offender. Accordingly, we have the view that the recommendations relating to sanctions are adequate in these circumstances. Mr. Speaker, your committee wishes to express gratitude to the House for the opportunity to serve in this capacity and to all persons who assisted in this task. Mr. Speaker, your committee submits its report without fear or favor or ill will towards any person. Respectfully submitted, Mr. Speaker.
To second the motion so ably moved by the chairman of the committee. Mr. Speaker, I believe that with the extensive presentation of your report before this honorable house, I have nothing more useful to add. Just to say that he who alleges must prove, and that is what your committee was faced with. Yes, the appointments committee were unable to prove same. Mr. Speaker, I second the motion.
Yeah.
Honourable members, order. Honourable members, the motion has been moved and seconded. It's for the consideration of the House. And we shall have the leaders to submit for our purposes. Honourable Minority Leader, if we have short comments from the leadership, then we shall put the question. If leaders, both leaders, will be reasonably brief.
Right, Honourable Speaker, let me use this opportunity.
Please, let me order.
Let me use this opportunity to make a comment on the report of the Special Committee investigating the bribery allegation made against the chairman and some members of the Appointments Committee. And in doing so, Mr. Speaker, to thank you for gathering the courage and pursuing the matter in the public interest, one, to redeem reputations and careers that could be ruined as a result of the allegation, and Mr. Speaker, to redeem and restore the dignity, honor, and respect for Parliament. Mr. Speaker, growing up, whether you swear by the Quran or swear by the Bible, anytime I hear any person say, in the name of God, I believe and trust that that person is on a path to be sincere and honest. So when you say anything and say, I do so in the name of God, it is to be interpreted both in the context of morality as being sincere with the truth. Mr. Speaker, this is not a matter that should have been taken lightly, because reputations are to be protected. And indeed, let me also use this opportunity to thank the chairman and members of the investigative committee for doing a diligent, thorough work. Indeed, I have known the Honorable Joe Ghartey and have worked with him on some matters of law. He has proven that in looking for how to establish the evidential burden, Mr. Speaker, he related to whether he was resorting to the civil requirement or the criminal requirement. But what impresses me is his depth of the knowledge in examining the matter and coming to the conclusions. What particularly excites me, Mr. Speaker, is the fact that the committee could go to the extent of reviewing CCTV cameras, a learning process for all of us. Who does what when? And who takes what when? Tomorrow is open to technology and related issues. Mr. Speaker, but at least for our purposes, nothing incriminating and nothing was established. Mr. Speaker, growing up as a young person and as a young lawyer, I will endeavor to keep my comment very brief. So let me thank the chairman of the committee and the other members of the committee for arriving at those conclusions. Today must mark a new beginning of who says what against who for all of us as members of parliament, and to jealously protect our individual reputations and integrity, and even more importantly, that of parliament. Mr. Speaker, I have perused developments in Italy, in the United Kingdom, and acts of MPs scandals can be sacrilegious if members of parliament cannot be trusted to have an integrity to lead. Mr. Speaker, this matter, if it was not handled through this openness, but even that, I'm sure there'll be some erosion of the public confidence and public trust in this institution of parliament and in members of parliament. Ethical self-control becomes an important matter for us. I note that the committee have made reference to contempt of parliament. The chairman have referred to Article 122 of the Constitution. Mr. Speaker, our colleague will respond to the issues of the findings. And in concluding, let me refer to that matter. In any ruling where an allegation is made, we all know what the evidential burden lies, the burden of proof. Indeed, growing up as a young lawyer, there was a ruling in a particular case that I was unhappy about. And in a private confidential discussion with the judge said, Aruna, the accused person could simply have said, and stand in the dock, and that is all. So that the burden is not on the accused person, but on the other person. Mr. Speaker, I can only say that even as we make references to our standing orders, reprimand or admonition, this is not a matter to which all of us cannot learn lessons going forward as members of this august house. I therefore once again want to thank you that it's important that this matter is brought this far so that the public can begin to have confidence in the members of parliament and in the institution of parliament. Probably when my colleague makes a comment and you still provide me an opportunity, I would be able, but with your leave, I want to thank you once again, members of the committee, and to say that this report, all of us must study it to guide us in our journey through Parliament and beyond. And the way we relate to each other and relate to this important institution to which our future ties. When it broke up, we risk a major political crisis if this was to be true. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minority Leader. Majority Leader. Order.
Mr. Speaker, let me also seize this opportunity to express my profound appreciation to the committee for a very excellent surgery that they have performed on a tumor that afflicted this house. Mr. Speaker, by the report, the house has been served with a total disembowelment of the matter before us, and all of us are seeing what is contained in the report and in the allegation. Mr. Speaker, the source of this alleged bribery scandal is the Honorable Ghartey Ejiakun. And indeed, Mr. Speaker, if he had been found wanting, we would have breached our orders, standing order 30K, which provides, Mr. Speaker, that the following acts of conduct shall constitute a breach of privilege or contempt of Parliament. The case says, attempts by improper or corrupt means to influence members or officers in their parliamentary duties. And that would have been a grievous offense. Mr. Speaker, again, it would have amounted to an act which obstructs or impedes Parliament in the performance of its functions or which obstructs or impedes a member or officer of parliament in the discharge of his duties or affronts the dignity of parliament. And that is also captured by Order 28. The Speaker, I'm happy that the committee, after this incisive probe, have come to the conclusion that the allegation against the Honorable Joe Oseusu, the first Deputy Speaker and Chairman of the Appointment Committee, the Honorable Muntaka Mohammed Mubarak, the Chief Whip for the Minority, and Honorable Bwachi Ejaku, the Minister responsible for energy, remains unproven. Mr. Speaker, by the report of the committee, and I refer to Bullet 78 of the report, the committee took evidence in camera from three witnesses, and the chairman of the committee, indeed the committee, related to Order 44 of outstanding orders, which prescribes that the Speaker may, in consultation with the House and having regard to public interest, order the House to move into closed sitting to discuss a particular subject or for the remainder of the sitting. The Speaker, they related to Order 44, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, which indeed relates to the conduct of business in plenary. The Speaker, let me emphasize that the committee is also fortified by Order 200, outstanding orders, which provides that in committees, the standing orders of the House shall be observed so far as may be applicable. So they committed no offense at all. What they did is in sync with the orders of this House. Mr. Speaker, the committee provides us with further illumination when they relate to the remit that was given to them to establish whether the first Deputy Speaker, Mr. Joseph Oseusu, who took money from the Energy Minister, Mr. Bwachi Ejaku, and gave it to the Minority Chief Whip, the Honorable Alhaji Muntaka Mubarak Mohammed, to be distributed to members of the Appointments Committee, that is, some members of the Appointment Committee. And the conclusion is unequivocal. The committee is unanimous that there is no evidence that Honorable Bwachi Ejaku gave money to Honorable Joseph Oseusu to bribe members of the Appointment Committee. Furthermore, there is no evidence that the committee can rely on in the view of the committee to lead it to the conclusion that the Honorable Joseph Oseusu gave money to Honorable Muntaka Mubarak for the purpose of bribing members of the Appointment Committee. The Speaker, this is very unambiguous. The second issue that they related to the second term of reference was to establish whether there were attempts to bribe members of the Appointment Committee. Mr. Speaker, I hope and pray honorable colleagues would have patience, because it is a matter that did not only affect the three members of the Appointment Committee mentioned, it affected all other members of the Appointment Committee and indeed the entire House. And it is for us as a House to interrogate the conclusions of the committee. And therefrom, Mr. Speaker, to afford ourselves the opportunity of learning useful lessons and if it is necessary to prescribe sanctions for those that we find guilty, what offense, what sanctions that we may prescribe, we should come to some agreement as a collective, as a house, to save the image of this house. That is why it is important to relate to it. People should not be in a hurry. The public has had patience. Mr. Speaker, in the not too distant past, there was a clear distinction between citizens and people. And clearly, there's a distinction between the presidency
and people.
Mr. Speaker, we are told by the committee that there is no evidence that money was given to members of the committee as bribe. And that is very, very informative. The conclusion is that on the basis of all accounts, the committee finds that there was no evidence of an attempt to bribe members of the appointment committee. Mr. Speaker, and that to me is very, very informative. And that statement of the committee should be treated with the sacrosanct that it deserves. That there is no basis whatsoever to establish the fact that there was any attempt to bribe any member of the appointment committee. Mr. Speaker, the committee then comes with recommendations to this House that the member for Boku Central, Mr. Mahama Ayariga, be reprimanded by the Right Honourable Speaker in accordance with Section 35 of the Parliament Act 1965 at 300, and that Mr. Mahama Ayariga renders an unqualified apology to the House, purging himself of contempt. The Speaker, the matter is before us, and the Speaker will make a ruling or provide directions in respect of the recommendations from the committee to this House. It is for this House to provide a lead to Mr. Speaker as to what may be done. Informatively, Mr. Speaker, the committee has stated that they took notice of the fact that the Honorable Mahama Ayariga is not known to have engaged, and I believe in previous instances, have engaged in acts that tend to disrupt the smooth proceedings of Parliament. The committee also concluded that the Honorable Mahama Ayariga does not have a penchant nor a reputation of engaging in activity which can bring the image and dignity of Parliament into disrepute. Again, save this very one. Accordingly, the committee is of the view that the recommendations relating to sanctions are adequate in the circumstances. Mr. Speaker, my prayer is that the conclusion provides sufficient mitigation that the Honorable Mahama Ayariga misconducted himself cannot be disputed from the trend established by the committee, the analysis, and the surgery committed by the committee. But we are at a critical juncture. What do we do as a House? And Mr. Speaker, I will pray the House that we
withdraw and we show mercy, we'll show remorse to begin. I will therefore advise you to advisedly pursue a more circumspect approach. You may continue.
Mr. Speaker, I don't know whether our primary concern is with the truth or giving closure to this case. Mr. Speaker, I don't know which one is our primary concern. Remember, Mr. Speaker, that there are cameras, and what we are discussing here is live on radio outside, and there are millions of Ghanaians who are listening and watching. And Mr. Speaker, they are discerning minds, and they are listening to us. How we conduct ourselves at this critical hour,
For the second time, Honorable Ayariga, certainly Ghanaians have discernment, but that discernment is not devoid of the 275 people who in their discernment and wisdom have elected to represent them in this august house. For the second time, I am respectfully advising you to pursue a course in your best interest. You may continue. Order. You may continue.
Mr. Speaker, I have every intention to show you utmost respect and act according to your directives. But I will do myself grave injustice if in rendering the apology, I do not point out certain matters that I also feel are important for you to advert your mind to. Mr. Speaker, in the first place, you set up a committee pursuant to order 191. First legal question is, does that committee have the power to come to conclusions relating to matters of contempt? Does it have the power? You set it up to find facts and report the facts to you. Does it have the power to come to conclusions on matters of contempt which are clearly spelled out in order 30, 31, and 32? Facts, not to conclude on contempt, because the issues of contempt are clearly defined in the standing orders. And so that is the first thing that I just wanted to advert your mind to, whether the committee can make findings and come to a conclusion that the provisions of contempt have been violated. That's the first question. Mr. Speaker, the second question is, they used criminal standards determining the burden of proof. Mr. Speaker, if you conclude that you want to use the criminal standard, then you might as well have, during the proceedings, used the criminal process. What is the criminal process? If you call a witness in any criminal trial, he should also cross-examine the other side so that you can come to the conclusion that will enable you to exact criminal sanctions. You didn't do that. Mr. Speaker, if you say I should apologize, I apologize.
Honorable members, order.